Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Our Voices, Our Histories, Asian American and Pacific Islander Women. Edited by Shirley Hune and Gail M. Nomura. Narrated by Raechel Wong. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. Our Voices. Gail M. Nomura. Our Voices, Our Histories, Asian American and Pacific Islander Women, brings together 35 Asian American and Pacific Islander authors in a single volume to explore the historical experiences, consciousness, and actions of Asian American and Pacific Islander women in the United States and beyond. It examines the intersections of race, gender, class, sexuality, indigeneity, ethnicity, and other aspects of the lives of these women. Through the voices and lives of the women themselves, these works foreground the agency, power, and resilience of Asian American and Pacific Islander women, and their capacity to enact change and transform their lives and communities within local, transnational, and global contexts. In addressing the diverse histories of Asian American and Pacific Islander women in this anthology, the editors recognize the heterogeneity within and between these socially and politically constructed pan-ethnic umbrella groupings. We do not seek to subsume, obliterate, or obscure their distinctiveness, but to expand the research and interpretive boundaries leading to new ways of understanding a complex, richer history of the United States. In addition to the many possibilities of dialogue, alliances, and connections through differences, we also seek to explore commonalities and shared agendas without perpetuating or reinscribing the same hierarchies and exclusions that have sometimes marred such projects. Effective coalition building constructs a shared agenda that is a work in progress, constantly negotiated and debated. It requires continuous interchanges to explore boundaries, frontiers, and borderlands of interactions and separations to open new conversations and collaborations. This book is a step toward exploring these interactions and separations, which will enable listeners to begin to question and push theoretical constructs and interpretations beyond the analyses of single ethnic groups. It will also allow listeners to more deeply consider the power of individual intentional action within, at times, seemingly overwhelming limits and constraints. The selections present new research that studies diverse aspects of Asian American and Pacific Islander American women's history, while acknowledging shared experiences as women of color in the United States. The authors bring fresh alternative insights, ways of knowing, analyses, and narratives, as well as research sources, approaches, and strategies. In this way, they reveal the agency, resistance, and resilience of Asian American and Pacific Islander women in all their diversity, and, in the process, a new understanding of women's history. Diversity. The Asian American and Pacific Islander women presented in this anthology comprise diverse groups of people of many cultures, ethnicities, languages, and religions that have a history with the United States. Diversity within and between groups is a key point to remember. Asian American is a socially and politically constructed pan-ethnic umbrella term, emerging out of the social movements of the 1960s and early 1970s in the United States. It generally refers to immigrants and U.S.-born people of Chinese, Filipino, Japanese, Korean, Mongolian, South Asian, for example, Bangladeshi, Bhutanese, Indian, Maldivian, Nepalese, Pakistani, Sri Lankan, Southeast Asian, for example, Burmese/Myanmarese, Hmong, Indonesian, Khmer/Cambodian, Lao, Malaysian, Mien, Singaporean, Thai, Vietnamese, Taiwanese, and Tibetan ancestry, among others. Some may expand the term to include peoples of Asian descent in all the Americas, and others have defined Asian as comprising peoples from the entire geographical region of Asia, including West Asia/the Middle East. Pacific Islander and Pacific Islander American are socially and politically constructed terms designating U.S.-born and immigrant people who have ancestry among the indigenous peoples from Oceania, Micronesia, Melanesia, and Polynesia. Most Pacific Islanders subscribe to a distinct island-based indigenous identity. For example, Native Hawaiian, Samoan, Chamorro, Tongan, Fijian, or Maori, rather than to a pan-ethnic identity. Pacific Islanders see clear sociocultural, political, and historical distinctions between and among different Islander groups. However, the pan-ethnic terms have come into use in recent years to forge a pan-Pacific Islander identity and coalitions, notably in the continental United States, while maintaining island-based identities. In particular, Pacific Islander and Pacific Islander American refer to indigenous peoples of Pacific Islands with a history of U.S. colonialism. 1. The state of Hawaii, incorporated into the United States in 1898 through a joint congressional resolution, organized as a U.S. territory in 1900, became the 50th state in 1959. 2. The U.S. territory of Guam, acquired by the United States by treaty from Spain in 1898, established as an unincorporated organized U.S. territory in 1950. 3. The Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands, CNMI, main islands Saipan, Tinian, and Rota, acquired by Germany from Spain in 1899, acquired by Japan after World War I as a League of Nations mandate, administered by the United States after World War II as part of the United Nations Trust Territory of the Pacific Islands, approved by the UN and the U.S. Congress, and by plebiscite to form the Commonwealth in political union with the United States, with a new constitution and government taking effect in 1978, and covenant agreement fully effective in 1986. 4. American Samoa, acquired by the United States in 1899, became an unorganized and unincorporated U.S. territory in 1900. The indigenous peoples of Hawaii, Guam, and the CNMI are U.S. citizens, except for a small number of people living in the CNMI who, in 1986, voluntarily chose to give up their newly acquired U.S. citizenship and remained non-citizen U.S. nationals. Indigenous Samoans born in American Samoa are non-citizen U.S. nationals. The terms Pacific Islander and Pacific Islander American also include the indigenous citizens of the three sovereign nations that comprise the Freely Associated States, or FAS. 1. The Federated States of Micronesia, or FSM, composed of the states of Yap, Chuuk, Pohnpei, and Kosrae. 2. The Republic of the Marshall Islands, or RMI. 3. The Republic of Palau, or ROP. The citizens of all three of the FAS nations currently have the rights to travel freely to live, work, and study in the United States and its territories or possessions under non-immigrant status, according to the terms of their individual nations' compacts of free association with the United States. Also, all Pacific Islander immigrants, indigenous peoples from Oceania, and their descendants born in the United States are included in the terms Pacific Islander and Pacific Islander American. A tension can exist between legal categories and self-identity when defining an American. For example, permanent residents may self-identify as American, and given issues of sovereignty and struggles for self-determination, some Pacific Islanders and U.S. colonized territories may not self-identify as American. The complexity of Asian American and Pacific Islander is illustrated by noting the many ethnicities included in the larger subcategories of Asian American, for example, Southeast Asian American, and the many different indigenous island groups encompassed by Pacific Islander. The pan-ethnic terms often obscure distinctions within these synthetic groupings. For example, the term South Asian American is often taken to mean Indian American, the most numerous ethnic group under that designation. Even the term Indian American masks, for example, regional, religious, and linguistic distinctions. Likewise, many take Pacific Islander to mean the numerically dominant subgroup Native Hawaiian, and the term Chamorro includes the Chamorro of Guam and the Chamorro of the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands, although separated politically since 1898 by imperial powers. Furthermore, the term Samoan includes those who are U.S. nationals from American Samoa, and those who come as immigrants to the United States from the independent state of Samoa. Further, if one interrogates a single ethnic category, such as Chinese American, one finds ethnic Chinese of varying national origins. For example, ethnic Chinese from Vietnam or the Philippines, and sometimes multiple national journeys. For example, Chinese who went to the United Kingdom, then Canada, then the United States, as well as those who conflate Taiwanese American with Chinese American. Distinct ethnicities emerge even in what seems to be an unambiguously homogeneous group, as in the case of Japanese Americans. Their genetic category often subsumes and obscures the distinct Okinawan American grouping. Adding to the inability to neatly define stable categories of classification are the growing numbers of multiracial, multi-ethnic peoples who trace their ancestries in part to Asia and/or the Pacific Islands. While in 1990, 10% of Asian Americans were multiracial, it is projected that by 2060, that rate will be nearly 20%. In 2015, 50% of Pacific Islanders were multiracial, and that rate is expected to increase to 54.5% by 2040. Generational differences further complicate relations within and among these groups. For example, some Asian Americans have histories of 7, 8, or more generations in the United States. But particularly since the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965 lifted many discriminatory policies and quotas against Asians, there has been a growing number of recent immigrants who brought their children with them, the 1.5 generation, those who were born in Asia but came as young children to the United States, and acculturated rapidly. After the Vietnam War, the fall of Saigon in 1975 prompted a sudden wave of refugees from Southeast Asia. And in the present, other refugees have come from Bhutan, Myanmar, Burma, and Nepal. Thus, the number of Asia-born immigrants in the United States increased exponentially. The Asian American population shifted from a small but predominantly U.S.-born population in 1960 to one of the fastest-growing racial groups in the United States, with at times almost two-thirds being immigrants. Though since 2000, there has been an increasing number of U.S.-born. Current projections indicate that by 2040, there will be an even numerical parity of U.S.-born and Asia-born. With this influx of new immigrants and refugees from Asia, enhanced by U.S. immigration policies that supported family reunification, the Asian American population more than doubled from 1.5 million in 1970 to 3.7 million in 1980, and nearly doubled again to 7.3 million in 1990. The Asian American population more than doubled again from 1990 to 2010, when the U.S. Census counted 17,320,856 Asian Americans, including mixed-race persons identifying as part Asian. Almost half those Asian Americans lived in the Western United States, and 52% were women. In 2017, the estimated number of Asian Americans was 22.4 million. The largest ethnic Asian American group, alone or in any combination, was Chinese, 5 million, excluding those who reported Taiwanese only, followed by Asian Indian, 4.4 million, Filipino, 4 million, Vietnamese, 2.1 million, Korean, 1.8 million, and Japanese, 1.5 million. More than 874,414 Pacific Islanders were enumerated in the 2000 U.S. Census, slightly less than 50%. 434,733 were women in 2000. Their numbers grew to 1,225,195 in 2010, and were an estimated 1.5 million in 2017. The largest group of Pacific Islanders in 2017 was Native Hawaiians, 614,572, followed by Samoans, 202,268, Chamorro or Guamanian, 156,482, Tongan, 71,474, Other Micronesian, 64,915, Fijian, 50,034, Marshallese, 34,970, Other Polynesian, 21,888, and Other Melanesian, 1,656. With another 249,558 not specified other Pacific Islander. Among Pacific Islanders, one finds generational and regional differences between the indigenous island resident and the off-island Pacific Islander living in or born and raised in the continental United States. Our voices. In coming together in this anthology, we and our authors collectively lift our voices with our subjects to narrate the complex history of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's history. Asian American and Pacific Islander women's voices and lives contest stereotyped mainstream views of them to reveal their strength, resilience, and transformative will and action in meeting the challenges of immigration/migration, colonialism, wars, economic globalization, transnationalism, racism, patriarchy, class, gender, and sexuality, family/community building, and changing intergenerational relations. Our authors share the voices of these women, which articulate that women are active agents in shaping their own lives and impacting their community, nation, and world, and not subordinate passive pawns of history. Their agency, their capacity to make their own strategic, intentional choices within changing opportunities and constraints presented, and to act on those choices, is a theme threading through all chapters in the volume. Our authors express the wide range of voices of Asian American and Pacific Islander women. In the chapters, we hear the voices of women who are indigenous, U.S.-born, immigrant, refugee, 1.5 and second generation, LGBTQ, mixed race, transracial adoptee, engaged in political action in the grassroots and legislative areas, experiencing trauma and healing, challenging race, gender roles, and class constraints, and contributing to the empowerment of women and community uplift, among others. Pacific Islander women voice the importance of understanding indigenous worldviews, historical stories, oral narratives, cultural practices and values, and connections with deities and the land, counter to Western thought, which represses alternative worldviews and relationships. Some of our authors, including the editors, reveal their own stories and voices alongside their subjects. In challenging our authors to step out of their academic third-person point of view positionality to share their stories and first-person points of view, the editors sought to bring to our listeners a more palpable connection to and understanding of Asian American and Pacific Islander women. One of our authors, Don Bohulanu Mabalan, expressed this view. "I also feel the hurt of a generation. It's our story, and it demands our love and attention and respect, and we need to tell this story." The passionate voices and personal stories of our authors add to the richness and depth of the stories they tell in their chapters. In particular, we recognize the courage of some of our authors in revealing their own intimate and sometimes painful experiences in their analyses of their subjects and, in some cases, their self-stories. In order to learn the history of Asian American and Pacific Islander women, we need to hear these voices. We must be respectful and listen, really listen, to the women and not impose our ill-informed ideas. The powerful voices and lived experiences of Asian American and Pacific Islander women in dialogue in this anthology illuminate the agency of these women throughout history and their multifaceted cultural formations and identities. The voices, dignity, and humanity of the women are at the core of the histories we have presented in this anthology. Their lives have meaning. Introduction. Our histories. Shirley Hune. The editors have developed Our Voices, Our Histories, Asian American and Pacific Islander Women to re-envision women's histories and to advance aspects and understandings of their lives through new approaches, methods, and resources. As we heard in the previous introduction, Asian American and Pacific Islander groups are complex and have unique voices and experiences. While maintaining their own cultural institutions and community organizations, they also collaborate intentionally for common goals and in resistance to discriminatory policies and treatment. As Asian American and Pacific Islander populations have grown numerically in the United States after the passage of the 1965 Immigration and Nationality Act, their members have become more multifaceted in national and ethnic origin. Status and condition of arrival and treatment in America, education, occupation and income, religion and spirituality, generation in America, family formations, and other characteristics. There is no single encompassing Asian American and Pacific Islander women's experience. Recent trends emphasize their diversity, but there are features of their experiences that are similar. The purpose of this volume is to contribute to a fuller comprehension of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's lives by bringing together a collection of their histories that incorporates cutting-edge research approaches, focuses on their different communities, as well as specific experiences in common, and highlights the women's voices and perspectives. In this introduction, I consider new dimensions in the scholarly focus of U.S. history, Asian American and Pacific Islander studies, and women's and gender studies that are reinterpreting Asian American and Pacific Islander women's histories, and explain how this book reflects these new approaches. The content of this anthology, its scope and coverage of ethnic groups and topics, and three interlocking themes, agency, resistance and resilience, and identity, are discussed. These themes flow through the chapters and elucidate the kinds of experiences the women have in common, in conjunction with their unique histories and lives. Finally, I outline how the volume is organized. In short, this book is a new anthology of original work grounded in historical studies that seeks to transform current understandings of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's histories. New Dimensions: Globalism and Transnationalism, Exclusion, Empire and Colonialism, and Gender and Intersectionality. In developing this anthology, the editors considered how new approaches in U.S. history, Asian American and Pacific Islander studies, and women's and gender studies inform research on Asian American and Pacific Islander women. I use the term dimensions to discuss cutting-edge approaches and recent research in history that are contributing to revisionist studies of Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders in general, and women specifically. Three of them help to frame the structure and organization of this volume. They have been developing for more than two decades and are not necessarily new. What is novel is our application of these approaches to Asian American and Pacific Islander women's histories. The new dimensions are akin to paradigm shifts that dramatically change previous interpretations, in this case, of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's lives. I discuss them briefly next. It is not possible, however, to do justice to these new approaches in this limited space. For more details, I have included extensive endnotes and citations of pertinent revisionist studies. Globalism and Transnationalism Dimension. Asian American and Pacific Islander histories have generally been studied through the lens of U.S. national history. As global historians challenge the dominance of nation-framed history, revisionist studies call for reinterpreting U.S. history as part of a global or world history of colonial relations, trade, labor migration, and other dynamics. Transnationalism involves relationships and the integration of people and political, economic, and cultural forms across national borders. Consequently, transnational aspects of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's histories, for example, memories and connections, become more visible and relevant. U.S. immigrant and refugee experiences have always been transnational, whatever the circumstances of their leavings and resettlements. But dominant ideologies have focused on their American lives and marginalized their global dimension. Diaspora studies is also of value. Its emphasis on emigrants with a shared history, culture, and geography who have dispersed to many distant lands, thus placing it outside the scope of this volume. New studies of both pre-mid-19th century migrants and post-1965 communities are recontextualizing Asian American and Pacific Islander histories within globalism and transnationalism. Chapters include these contexts for early Chinese, Filipino, Indian, Japanese, and Korean women and present-day experiences of females of Bangladeshi, Chamorro, Chinese, Filipino, Hmong, Indian, Japanese, Khmer/Cambodian, Korean, Laotian, Samoan, Taiwanese, Thai, Tongan, and Vietnamese backgrounds, integrating them with their lives in the United States. Several chapters discuss transnational and local dynamics in areas, such as the role of food, the politics of language, being a transracial adoptee, lesbian or of mixed race, and organizing across ethnic groups and national borders, to include a larger range of women's activities than has generally been addressed. Exclusion, Empire, and Colonial Dimension. Reflecting the nation-state focus of both U.S. history and immigration studies, earlier frameworks of Asian Americans emphasized immigrant chronicles and assimilation and adaptation, albeit interlocked with their resistance to racism and other inequities. The idea of the United States as a welcoming nation of immigrants has been systematically countered. In particular, Asian exclusion policies have long contradicted this concept. Revisionist studies, including indigenous and post-colonial critiques, highlight exclusion, empire, and colonialism in national and global history, especially the impact of imperialism, wars, military interventions, and colonial occupations on the displacement, forced relocation, and accompanying violence and trauma experienced by specific Asian American and Pacific Islander groups. Chapters document the varied experiences of Asian American and Pacific Islander women under empire in earlier eras and less studied locations. They also feature recent histories of Filipino, South and Southeast Asian, and Pacific Islander women whose lives were considerably changed by empire, war, and colonial occupation. The dimension of exclusion, empire, and colonialism also shifts the geography of Asian American and Pacific Islander studies from solely the U.S. continent to the larger Pacific world, its oceans, islands, and lands. This approach is more inclusive of former U.S. colonies and territories, their histories, populations, and issues, including addressing American influence in their homelands. Several chapters offer new interpretations of Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander women's activities, resistance and resilience, and identities through their histories and voices. Gender and intersectionality dimension. As women's and gender studies give more attention to non-white, non-Western women and their situations, locally, nationally, and globally, they bring visibility to female migrants around the globe. Feminists have also adopted gender as an analytical category for considering women's disparities, especially the ideologies and practices that privilege men and disadvantage women. In this volume, the editors build upon our efforts to view Asian American and Pacific Islander women as historical subjects actively negotiating better lives for themselves, their families, and their communities within constraints of gender biases, laws, and customs, a construct we introduced in Asian/Pacific American Women, a historical anthology, 2003. Chapters extend that construct to richly detail Asian American and Pacific Islander women's agency, resistance and resilience, and identity as common themes as they confront gender boundaries in their families, communities, work situations, and public spaces in U.S. society and their homelands. As a component of gender studies, intersectionality focuses on different hierarchies of power, such as race, gender, sexuality, class, religion, ability, etc., as they combine and overlap, conflict or contest, accumulate over time, and complicate women's struggle for equality in a male-dominated Western world. We incorporate intersectionality in this book to reveal the complexity of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's lives, as they may hold different advantages and disadvantages in particular eras, places, and situations. For example, several chapters discuss how religious affiliation or spirituality intersects with race, class, gender, and other hierarchies in different historical times and locations, to inform the women's agency, resistance and resilience, and search for identity. Scope and content. Time frame. This anthology extends previous time frames of Asian American and Pacific Islander histories through chapters that span from creation narratives of Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders and Asian migration in the 1500s to their lives in the early 21st century. They include cutting-edge research findings that incorporate globalism and transnationalism, exclusion, empire, and colonialism, and gender and intersectionality dimensions in their analyses. Locations. We expand the geographical terrain of Asian American and Pacific Islander studies with chapters on women's experiences in less studied regions of the United States, the South, the Midwest, and New England, and in the islands of the Pacific. Other chapters introduce lesser-known voices, histories, and concerns of Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders in America and their birthplaces. There are also discussions of women's transnational experiences and their struggle against the dominance of U.S. mainstream culture in their homelands and the United States. Diversities. Chapters include more diversities of Asian American and Pacific Islander women as ethnic groups and social classes, and as transracial adoptees, lesbians, mixed-race persons, and different generations, such as youth and the elderly, than have generally been featured in prior works. This volume is also distinctive in that several chapters feature 1.5 and second-generation women as young adults in various historical times and places. And there are additional findings on long-standing topics of immigration, family, work, community, and political engagement. Moreover, the anthology also increases knowledge of women's lives, with topics such as food studies, religious affiliations, and spirituality, cultural performance, aging, the life course, alternative family formations, professional women, and intergenerational dynamics. Gender dynamics/life histories. Chapters provide thick details on gender dynamics and intersections, such as women's initiatives in migration, family and community building, challenging race and gender biases and obstacles in their careers, pushing boundaries in institutional settings like the church and academia, engaging in political change, ranging from national legislation to community practices, and holding highly visible community leadership and professional positions. Life histories also expand gendered analyses of Asian American and Pacific Islander lives by addressing women's relations with spouses, partners, children, siblings, parents, grandparents, coworkers, community members, and others. Throughout the anthology, our authors identify individual women and provide their voices, life histories, and contributions, some at great length. This approach notably advances research findings on Asian American and Pacific Islander women, who for too long have been invisible, unidentified, unheard, and unnamed. Themes in common: agency, resistance and resilience, identity. Three interrelated themes also course through the chapters linking Asian American and Pacific Islander women's experiences across time, topics, and communities. First is their agency or proactive participation as the women navigate new lives in different eras and through various lands, locations, and situations. The term agency here refers to a set of behaviors, such as a collectivity of aims, actions, initiatives, activities, and strategies that they undertake consciously and unconsciously every day to ensure their and their family's well-being. Second is the women's resistance and resilience as they contest racism, sexism, and other inequalities in U.S. society, and as part of globalism and transnationalism, exclusion, empire, and colonialism, and as they oppose injustices in their families, communities, and homelands, while resolving to survive, keep to their goals, and persist through difficult times and impediments. Third is the women's expression of and search for new identities that are more representative of who they are or are becoming, and what is important to them in the midst and aftermath of changing structures, conditions, and life courses, despite multiple constraints. Identity formation and sense of self are not fixed, but fluid, as their consciousness, lives, and encounters change. Methods and resources. A strength of this anthology is the many ways in which contributing authors center Asian American and Pacific Islander women's voices and experiences through a wide range of methods and resources. Many are innovative. Most chapters employ traditional historical research methods and print archival sources. A few chapters include new media-based archives, especially films, videos, and digital formats, which are sometimes self-created. The telling of stories to record history, whether ancestral and passed from generation to generation, an especially important part of Pacific Islander women's historical knowledge, or contemporary and reflective of cultural practice, is integral to many chapters in this volume. Forms of storytelling, including oral history, often in conjunction with ethnographic studies, interviews, life and self histories, multimedia materials, memoirs, and autobiographies, provide findings on Asian American and Pacific Islander women in the 20th and early 21st centuries from a historical perspective. Our authors are inspirational in identifying new and underutilized resources, such as community archives, and innovating through peer and youth-centered practices to document the evolving and often hidden histories, activities, and lives of Asian American and Pacific Islander women of all ages. Organization. In this historically grounded anthology, the editors have organized the main body of the volume into 8 parts, which are roughly chronological around broad time periods that overlap. This approach allows for an unfolding of Asian American and Pacific Islander histories over time, and for assessments of the women's experiences within similar historical eras. Each part gives attention to a wide-ranging but significant topic in the women's lives, and consists of 3 or 4 chapters of different ethnic groups. Listeners can both appreciate the women's distinct histories and assess their common experiences. The editors have prepared an introduction to each part to explain its subject matter and the contributions of the chapters within it. The parts are 1. Early era indigenous and global roots. 2. New intersections of race, gender, generation, communities. 3. New cultural formations, new selves. 4. War times and aftermath. 5. Globalization, work, family, community, activism. 6. Spaces of political struggles. 7. New diasporas, diverse lives, evolving identities. And 8. Gender, cultural change, intergenerational dynamics. We recognize that chapters often have more than one focus, dimension, or theme, and could alternatively be grouped with other chapters. No single volume can be comprehensive, nor can we represent here all the voices and histories of Asian American and Pacific Islander women, nor can the chapters in each part fulfill all aspects of its focus. To close, the editors briefly provide reflections as an afterword. This anthology provides a fresh perspective on Asian American and Pacific Islander women's histories. We designed it to showcase innovative ways of approaching and doing Asian American and Pacific Islander women's histories, to support ongoing reinterpretations, to be accessible for specialists, students, and a general audience, and to present some of the exciting, leading-edge research on Asian American and Pacific Islander women being undertaken today. Part 1. Early Era, Indigenous, and Global Roots. Part 1 emphasizes the early era of Asian American and Pacific Islander women's diverse histories in a broad sweep, from creation cosmology to the late 20th century for Native Hawaiians, and from the 1500s to pre-World War II for Asian Americans. Integrating indigenous approaches and the dimensions of globalism and transnationalism, exclusion, empire, colonialism, and gender and intersectionality, 3 chapters reconsider how, when, where, and why Asian American and Pacific Islander women become part of the history of what is now the United States. The authors bring early women out of the shadows, by featuring noteworthy Native Hawaiian and Asian American women as historical agents of change. Class as an intersectional element also helped to explain women's disparities in opportunity, treatment by U.S. society, and access to resources. We begin with Daviana Pomaka'i McGregor, who examines the roles and agency of Native Hawaiian women historically, from the creative and reproductive female forces of nature to high chiefesses and national leaders, to family matriarchs, educators, and healers. These powerful and enduring female ancestors provide cultural guidance to heal and nurture families, communities, and nation. And they are sources to draw upon for meeting current and future struggles in everyday life. Utilizing the multi-generational wisdom and experience of the ancestors, contemporary Native Hawaiian women leaders are empowered to redress a history of colonialism and homeland destruction, and to address disparities such as income, education, and health. Global and immigration historians like Erica Lee are reassessing early Asian emigration, especially under empire, and providing a new history of their pre-19th century lives in the Americas. Lee discusses how the roots of early women's migration from China, Japan, Korea, the Philippines, and South Asia were shaped by colonialism from the mid-1500s to 1815. Vignettes of individual women of variable class backgrounds document their gendered emigration patterns, their work and family lives, and state officials and others' treatment of them as determined by ideologies of women's subordination and as dependents in their homelands in the United States. They also confirm the women's agency in challenging adverse conditions and discriminatory laws and practices, so that they could play a significant role in helping to build early Asian American families and communities before World War II. Masako Ino's chapter discusses the transnational lives of two sisters from Japan's elite. Ume Tsuda was one of a number of Asian women who came to the United States in the 19th century for education. She arrived in 1871 at the age of 6, earned a degree from Bryn Mawr College, and chose to return to Japan to found Tsuda College for Women in 1900. Her younger sister, Yona Abiko, emigrated to San Francisco and became a leader in the Japanese American community. Both sisters developed a network of American women friends who supported their efforts to empower women through education. Their remarkable lives among the educated U.S. elite expand understandings of the intersections of race, gender, class, religion, friendships, and individual will in advancing women's aspirations. These three chapters underscore that early Native Hawaiian and Asian American women were more diverse in background, circumstances, and access to resources, networks, and opportunities than has generally been appreciated. Yet they were actively engaged in similar efforts to determine their lives. Hence, their futures varied. Their distinct histories allow us to focus more attention on indigenous and transnational experiences, intersectionality, Hawaii, region, class, and cultural knowledge's influences on the women's ability to exercise their agency and forge new paths and identities in the early era. 1. Malama Lama. Reconnecting as Native Hawaiian women through cultural history. Daviana Pomaika'i McGregor. Reflection. Kohe Malama Lama o Kanaloa. The Shining Birth Canal of Kanaloa is one of the original names of the island that, by my generation of Native Hawaiians, had come to be known as Kaho'olawe. The island was bombed and used for military training exercises from December 8, 1941, the day after Pearl Harbor was bombed, until a vibrant Native Hawaiian movement that started in 1976 succeeded in stopping the bombing on October 22, 1990. As a professor of ethnic studies at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, I engaged my students with the movement, circulating petitions, setting up informational tables, organizing teach-ins. But I had only reached the shores of the island in 1983. Impressed by her stark beauty, despite gaping erosive wounds, I had joined the Protect Kaho'olawe Ohana, hereafter Ohana, to stop the military assaults and to work to heal and restore her landscape and resources. The Ohana delved deep into Kaha'olawe Mo'olelo, historic stories, chants, and place names. Through Kupuna, elders, we learned her original names and sacred nature as a manifestation of Kanaloa, Hawaiian god of the ocean. It was a center for training of navigators in the arts of wayfinding. As we rededicated cultural sites under the guidance of Auntie Edith Kanaka'ole and the Edith Kanaka'ole Foundation, we revived Hawaiian spiritual beliefs, customs, and practices, and these spread throughout Hawaii. We began to observe the natural phenomena that our ancestors experienced at these cultural sites and realized that they had been constructed to mark the passage of time with the daily and seasonal movement of the sun and the monthly cycles of the moon. In 2014, as the Ohana planned for the island's future, we reached the collective insight that the island actually serves as a portal through which we reconnect with our ancestors, their wisdom, experience, science, and beliefs, and the natural life forces that they honored as deities. In an aha moment, as we searched for the translation of portal into Hawaiian, came the insight that the deepest meaning of the name Kohe Malama Lama o Kanaloa is that of the ultimate portal, the passage from the realm of creation into the realm of the living. Our ancestors, too, had experienced the island as a sacred portal. I share this story as an example of an indigenous approach to problem solving and planning. Upon recognizing a problem, an injustice, a challenge, start to intentionally research cultural histories, Hawaiian sources and practices, to derive alternative insights, narratives, approaches, and strategies. These provide excellent models for planning actions. This chapter shares the vital role and agency of Native Hawaiian women throughout history as an inspiration and resource for dealing with contemporary problems. It opens by acknowledging the challenges that Native Hawaiian women face in 2018, which is reflected in the health and well-being of Native Hawaiian women compared to non-Hawaiian women in the islands. It then examines the central and powerful role of women historically in Hawaiian cosmology, traditional Hawaiian society, and in the 19th century, where royal women challenged American imperialism and used their own resources to provide for our people in perpetuity. Next, the chapter explores trends in the livelihoods and living conditions in the 20th century, and women who distinguished themselves as perpetuators of Native Hawaiian beliefs, customs, and practices, despite the colonization of Hawaii as a U.S. territory. Finally, I discuss the ways in which Native Hawaiian women find inspiration, agency, and insights from our historic deities, chiefesses, and leaders in taking up the challenges facing Native Hawaiian women today. Disparities. Hawaii is an archipelago in the Central Pacific Ocean with 8 major islands. Native Hawaiians sustained a healthy, self-sufficient social and governance system until contact with the West in 1778. Foreign diseases, a capitalist plantation system, Western settlers, and Asian immigrant contract labor caused the population to collapse and the social, political, and economic dislocation of Native Hawaiians. At 21% of the population in 2010, Native Hawaiians are a minority within the homeland. In May 2018, the Office of Hawaiian Affairs published a report, Haumea, Transforming the Health of Native Hawaiian Women and Empowering Wahine Well-Being, which provided the statistics on disparities faced by Native Hawaiian women, or wahine. The report notes that economically, wahine aged 25 and older hold 14.3% fewer post-secondary degrees than the statewide average. In 2016, the mean earnings for wahine was $44,620, or $5,967 less than non-Hawaiian females. In the 2010 U.S. Census, wahine comprised 43.7% of the women's prison population. With regard to mental health, from 2012 to 2016, nearly 1 in 5 wahine, or 19.3%, considered their mental health not good for 1 to 6 days of the month. In the same period, more Native Hawaiian females in public high schools, or 24.1%, seriously considered attempting suicide, compared to non-Hawaiian females, or 18.7%. In health issues between 2009 and 2013, Wahine had the highest incidence, 17.4% of, and mortality, 13.4%, from breast cancer among women in Hawaii. Between 2012 and 2016, Wahine also had higher rates of chronic disease in comparison with non-Hawaiian females in Hawaii. 11.2% versus 8.5% for type 2 diabetes, 37.7% versus 17.6% for obesity, 3.4% versus 2.1% for heart attack, and 3.7% versus 2.8% for stroke. Stark disparities exist in birth statistics, as a 10-year aggregate shows 45% of the extremely preterm births in Hawaii occur with Native Hawaiian mothers, and Native Hawaiians have the highest rates of infant mortality in Hawaii, 2.3 times higher than Caucasians. Similar to the planning approach suggested in this chapter, the report invokes the female deity Haumea, also known as Papa, and customary Native Hawaiian approaches, sources for inspiration, and methods to empower Wahine to improve our health. Inspiration. Hawaiian mo'olelo demonstrate that women hold powerful positions, play vital roles, and are central to the documentation and transmission of knowledge through the generations. In traditional mo'olelo, Native Hawaiians acknowledge the creative and reproductive female forces of nature as being powerful and vital in and of themselves and in complement with male forces of nature. For example, Papa Nui Hano Moku, Great Papa who gives birth to the islands, or Papa, embodies the female elements and processes from which life evolves in the Hawaiian Islands, through her relationship with the male procreative element, Vakea, the deity of the sky. According to Pualani Kanaka Ole Kanahele, Hawaiian ancestors also identified Papa as the organizer of scientific observation and documentation. In her analysis of the Kumulipo, a chant documenting the origin and evolution of life in the Hawaiian Islands, Kanahele explains that the 13th va, or era of the chant, describes how Papa organized scientific observations and knowledge into three schools of science: Papahulilani, Papahulihonua, and Papahanaumoku. Papahulilani is the school of knowledge about natural elements that exist in the atmosphere, the sky, and the broad universe, corresponding to meteorology, atmospheric sciences, and astronomy. Papahulihonua is the science of the earth, corresponding to geology, geography, oceanography, and other earth and ocean sciences. Papahanaumoku is the science of reproduction and life process of all living beings and organisms, from humans and animals to insects and microbes, and corresponds to medical and life sciences. The composers of the Kumulipo honored Papa as central to the development and transmission of ancestral scientific wisdom. Two other essential female deities are Hina and Pele. Hina embodies the processes related to the daily, monthly, and seasonal cycles of the moon and the related tidal fluctuations of the ocean. Her forms include the moon, coral reefs, marine reef life, and ocean caves. In a mo'olelo, Hina is the mother of Maui, who asks him to challenge the established order and secure innovations that improve the lives of the people. Fire, more islands, longer days during half of the year, and a higher sky. Pele embodies one of the most awesome and magnificent creative forces of nature, the volcano, and all the explosive and dynamic forces of its eruption. In 1983 and 2018, the Kilauea volcano eruptions and lava flows on Hawaii Island reaffirmed her continued existence. The powerful forces of healing and revitalization of the land following a volcanic eruption, essentially the ability to evoke life from death, are attributed to her sister, Hi'iaka Ika Poli o Pele, Hi'iaka in the bosom of Pele. Women and the Ohana, the foundation of the Hawaiian social system. The core Native Hawaiian culture established between 300 and 1200 revolved around the productive and reproductive activities that were organized through the ohana, or extended family. As Native Hawaiian society evolved, gender played a major role in defining the lives of the people. The responsibilities of the women revolved around their natural childbearing role, distinct from those of the men. Men cultivated food plants, did deep-sea fishing, and cooked the food. Women's work included gathering resources of the forest, streams, and reefs, and materials used for thatching, clothing, rope, mats, sails, and so forth. Kapu, or sacred restrictions, defined the roles of men and women in religious ceremonies and rituals. Women conducted ceremonies to cleanse participants, places, and structures, including heiau, or temples, in preparation for rituals. Women worshipped in specific female temples called hale opapa, which are not found elsewhere in Polynesia. Aikapu, sacred eating restrictions, defined the preparation and eating of food for men and women and date back to the time of Vakea. Men and women ate separately, and their food was prepared in separate underground imu, or ovens, by the men. Women were restricted from eating selected foods that were considered to be the representations of male gods. Between 1200 and 1500, the migration of men and women from Tahiti to Hawaii brought new influences. The cultures merged both through intermarriage of the Tahitian chiefs with Hawaiian women of prominent indigenous genealogical lines, and as a result of battles and conquest. The lives of the men and women of the ohana remained stable and improved with technological innovations in fishing, farming, and irrigation. Beginning in 1500 and up through European contact in 1778, chiefs emerged as rulers of the native Hawaiian social system. Women were born into sacred and chiefly roles in the social hierarchy, and they were raised to be free from day-to-day labors and were accorded special privileges, although they were still subject to the aikapu. While society was patriarchal in political rule, the highest-ranking women of sacred birth could, nevertheless, determine which chief's son would inherit rank and privilege through his choice of mate. Often chiefs of lower rank would attempt to ascend in genealogical status by usurping the sexual power of the sacred chiefess. Women were also important chiefs. Oahu's first female paramount chief, Kukani Loko, generation 106 in AD 1540, ruled over a period of peace and order. She was succeeded by her daughter, Kalaimanu'ia, who was praised by the historian Samuel Kamakau as a good chiefess, whose governance allowed the ali'i, ruling chiefs, and maka'ainana, commoners, to live in comfort. During her reign, she oversaw the construction of the pa'ayao, opu, and kapa'akea fish ponds. On the island of Hawaii, High Chiefess Kaikilani jointly ruled first with Kanalua Ku'a'ana, and then with Lanoi Kamakahiki. When the British explorer Captain James Cook first arrived on Kauai in January 1778, High Chief Kaneoneo jointly ruled with his wife, High Chiefess Kamakahele. By the time Cook returned in November 1778, High Chiefess Kamakahele had allied with High Chief Kaeokalani to take over control of Kauai. Women and the Hawaiian Monarchy. With European and American contact and trade, the development of a capitalist social system in Hawaii began to redefine the chiefs and chiefesses' roles in relation to commoner men and women. High Chief Paea Kamehameha took advantage of Western trade and utilized military technology in his battles to conquer and unite the chiefdoms of Hawaii under his central rule, establishing the Kingdom of Hawaii as King Kamehameha I. Native Hawaiian women of chiefly birth trained as warriors under Kamehameha, who himself had three divisions of chiefly women warriors trained in lua, the Native Hawaiian fighting arts. Notably, the warrior chiefesses who accompanied their husbands into Kamehameha's Battle of Nu'u'anu on Oahu were specially trained to be adept in the shooting of Western muskets and were the first line of offense against the Oahu chiefs. Upon the death of King Kamehameha I, High Chiefess Ke'opu'olani, the mother of his sons and successors Kamehameha II and Kamehameha III, was the highest-ranking and most sacred chiefess in the islands. High Chiefess Ka'ahumanu was the most politically influential wife of King Kamehameha I, whose brothers and uncles constituted his principal allies in his rise to power. The position of Kuhina Nui, or Prime Minister, was created for her to jointly rule with King Kamehameha II. The two chiefly women, Ke'opuolani and Ka'ahumanu, worked with the Council of Chiefs to achieve a successful transition of rule. The Ainoa, the abolition of the system of chiefly kapu under which the rival chiefs claimed divine power, prestige, and rights of succession, was key for the transition of governance to Kamehameha II. Once abolished, the right to rule became secular and based upon military power and faithful service to the central government of the king, the Kuhina Nui, and the appointed council of chiefs. High Chiefess Manono joined her husband, High Chief Kekuaokalani, in opposing the Ainoa and fighting in the Battle of Kuamo'o, where they were both killed. Her motto, Malama Ko Aloha, or Care for and Perpetuate Love and Respect for All, inspired her own resistance and continues to be an ideal inspiring work for social justice. The Ainoa also abolished the restrictions upon women and opened the way for the roles of both women and men at all levels of society to be redefined. While the liberation of women, especially those of chiefly rank, was a critical factor in the Ainoa, the primary motivation was to undermine the status of rival ritual chiefs, who claimed traditional privilege and rank, and threatened to overturn the central government. With the Ainoa, there was no longer a division of labor or restrictions on the consumption of resources according to gender. Commoner women assumed a greater role in production for the households of Ohana, including cultivation and food preparation, when men were increasingly drawn into wage labor outside the household, as sailors and stevedores for whaling ships, as teamsters and haulers for merchants, as cowboys on ranches, and as manual laborers on plantations. The Ohana of the Maka'ainana, or commoner class, bore the burden of social and economic change under the monarchy. Native Hawaiian families suffered catastrophic loss of lives from foreign diseases throughout the 19th century. Historian Samuel Kamakau reports that thousands died in 1826 of an epidemic of cough, congested lungs, and sore throat. And in 1848, measles carried away about a third of the population of Hilo, Hawaii. Consequently, a pre-contact estimated population of 400,000 to 800,000 was reduced to 40,622 in 1890. Under the traditional social system, land was sacred and could not be owned. The chiefs, and later the king, provided stewardship over the land, and the entitlement of the Ohana to live upon and cultivate the land for subsistence was recognized and honored, provided they also gave tribute and labor service to the chief. The unprecedented establishment of a Western system of private property by King Kamehameha III through a process called mahele, meaning division, left the majority of Ohana landless. When the final land grants were made under the Kuleana Act of 1850, 8,205 Maka'ainana received 28,600 acres, or 0.8% of all of the lands of Hawaii. Some of the women in the burgeoning port towns of the islands were drawn into prostitution. There, Native Hawaiian women also worked as nurses, house servants, washerwomen, and serving women, earning from $1 to $10 a week, about half of men's usual wages. However, it was primarily the women who remained with the families and households of Ohana and held them together day to day. They also cultivated the taro and sweet potato fields and gathered food upland from the streams and from nearshore reefs. Between 1820 and 1845, the role of Native Hawaiian women was equal to that of men. Native Hawaiian women could own property, participate in elections, and freely leave intolerable marriages. Beginning in 1845, Western laws were adopted and included restrictions on the rights of women in Hawaii. From 1845 through its repeal in 1888, the Hawaiian kingdom adopted a coverture law from Massachusetts, whereby a married woman surrendered ownership of her property and the right to conduct business to her husband. Upon her death, the husband received 1/3 interest in the wife's fixed property, and the remainder passed on to her heirs. Likewise, upon death of the husband, the widow received a dower of 1/3 life interest in her husband's fixed property, and an absolute 1/3 ownership of his movable property. In 1850, women were denied the right to vote that they had previously exercised. In 1860, the law required a married woman to adopt her husband's name. Women Ali'i. While Western laws began to limit the rights of women in Hawaii, chiefly women, unlike the commoner women, retained significant political power and owned property. They also attained significant positions in government equal to men. The position of the Kuhina Nui, held by High Chiefess Ka'ahumanu, made her equal in power to King Kamehameha II. When he died in London of measles in 1824, his brother became Kamehameha III at the age of 9, and Kuhina Nui Ka'ahumanu ruled as regent until she passed away in 1832. Except for the period from 1844 through 1855, the Kuhina Nui were chiefly women from the creation of the office in 1819 until it was abolished in 1864. King Kamehameha V asked Bernice Pauahi Bishop to succeed him as ruler, but she declined to take on that responsibility. Through an election, King Lunalilo succeeded King Kamehameha V. When he passed away without naming a successor, another election was held. Queen Emma, widow of King Kamehameha IV, was a candidate against Chief David Kalakaua to succeed as ruler. Kalakaua became king, and his sister, Liliuokalani, succeeded him as the queen and last monarch of the Hawaiian kingdom. Chiefly women also served in the Council of Chiefs and in the House of Nobles. Under the Mahele, 5 of the 10 high chiefs to receive lands were women, and 10 of the 24 lesser chiefs to receive lands were women. 3 native Hawaiian queens and a princess endowed the native Hawaiian people with their landed estates in perpetuity. One by one, as they passed away in the late 19th century, not having children who survived them, the landed ali'i bequeathed their substantial personal landholdings to the common native Hawaiian people in the form of perpetual charitable trusts that generate revenues to provide programs for the education, health, and general welfare of the common people. The private landholdings of the Kamehameha chiefs, totaling 369,699 acres, or 9% of all the land in Hawaii, were consolidated into the Bernice Pauahi Bishop estate after the death of Princess Pauahi in 1884. In her will, Princess Pauahi stated that she wanted her trustees to provide an education in such useful knowledge as may tend to make good and industrious men and women. Her trust established and still funds the Kamehameha schools for the education of Native Hawaiians. Queen Emma, widow of King Kamehameha IV, was concerned for the health and education of Native Hawaiians. In 1859, she and the king established the Queen's Hospital to provide free health care for Native Hawaiians. And in 1867, she helped found St. Andrew's Priory, an Episcopalian school for girls. In 1885, when she passed away, her trust of 13,064 acres was established to fund Queen's Hospital and scholarships for Native Hawaiian girls to attend the priory. As noted earlier, Queen Emma sought election to be the monarch under the motto Hawaii for the Hawaiians. The key issue of the campaign in 1874 was the ceding of Keawalao Opu'uloa, or Pearl Harbor, to the United States for its exclusive use in return for a reciprocal trade agreement that would eliminate a tariff on Hawaii sugar. Queen Emma opposed the ceding of Pu'uloa, and Kalakaua supported it. Although Kalakaua won the election, Queen Emma remained a prominent icon of resistance to U.S. influence over Hawaii. Throughout the decades, Queen Emma persists as a prominent role model of strength, benevolence, compassion, and perseverance in the face of adversity, especially for women involved in medicine, public health, social work, and politics, and the students and alumni of the Priory. Concerned for the welfare of Native Hawaiian mothers and their babies, Queen Kapi'olani, the widow of King Kalakaua, willed her estate to the maintenance of the Queen Kapi'olani Maternity Hospital, which she helped found in 1890. Her inspirational model, Kulia Ika Nu'u, or Strive for the Highest, guided the development of that institution into the modern Kapi'olani Medical Center for women and children, and has been embraced by generations of Native Hawaiians, women and men, who strive for excellence in all endeavors. In 1909, Queen Liliuokalani established the Queen Liliuokalani Children's Center by executing a deed placing the lands from her estate, totaling 9,793 acres, in trust to provide social services support to orphaned and indigent Native Hawaiian children. Her motto, Onipa'a, to be steadfast and stand firm in the shifting tides of change, continues to inspire the work of those carrying out the mandate of her trust. It also inspires the contemporary Native Hawaiian movement for sovereignty and self-determination. The women Ali'i bequeathed a remarkable legacy to future generations of Native Hawaiians, whose well-being diminished as they were increasingly marginalized in their homeland by settlers. As the sugar economy flourished with the implementation of the Reciprocity Treaty with the United States and the importation of migrant contract labor, Native Hawaiians continued to succumb to foreign diseases and were displaced from ancestral lands. Collectively, these trusts for whom the Native Hawaiian people are beneficiaries provide a solid foundation for the Native Hawaiian people today in our pursuit of social justice and the excellent health and well-being of our people. The overthrow of Queen Liliuokalani and the Hawaiian monarchy. The Hawaiian monarchy established in 1810 was overthrown on January 17, 1893. By U.S. naval forces while Queen Liliuokalani held the throne. In her book, Hawaii's Story by Hawaii's Queen, she reveals her strategy to surrender to the U.S. government, rather than to the provisional government in the belief that the president and Congress would eventually restore her to power upon an investigation of the treasonous conspiracy against her by U.S. citizens and diplomatic representatives. She also believed that this pathway would prevent bloodshed. While President Grover Cleveland did appeal to Congress to denounce the provisional government and reinstate the Queen, Congress upheld the invasion of Hawaii and the diplomatic recognition of the provisional government. Queen Liliuokalani grew to represent the sovereignty and national integrity of the Native Hawaiian people and became the focal point of Native Hawaiian protest against American rule and assimilation from the end of the 19th century through the 20th century. Her motto, Onipa'a, is interpreted as a call to persevere and endure as a people. For the generations of Native Hawaiians born in the 20th century, Native Hawaiian national consciousness and identity are symbolized by the image of the Queen. Regal, beautiful, defiant, proud, enduring. Onipa'a was a call for future generations of Native Hawaiians to live, practice, and perpetuate their native language, culture, science, spiritual beliefs, and customs, and to endure as a distinct people, despite American efforts to extinguish Hawaiian language and culture and to assimilate Native Hawaiians into the U.S. social system. Territorial years. At the beginning of the 20th century, after Hawaii was incorporated into the United States as a territory, irrigation systems were constructed to carry water from the windward sides of the island to open new sugar plantations on the leeward sides of the islands, which increased sugar production. The diversion of stream waters negatively impacted year-round taro production in some rural areas, leading Native Hawaiians to migrate into the cities for new livelihoods. In the cities, Native Hawaiian women began to be represented in all classes of labor, and their condition of life was determined primarily by their class status rather than according to their gender. Native Hawaiian women who moved to Honolulu entered the workforce, working part-time as hula dancers, lay makers, greeters, waitresses, and hotel workers. They also worked in the pineapple canneries and as clerical workers and telephone operators. And they entered the professions of teaching and nursing. Nevertheless, the majority of Native Hawaiian women continued to work as homemakers, and most of them remained in rural communities, where they continued to rely on subsistence fishing and farming, guided by Native Hawaiian cultural beliefs and knowledge. By 1930, Native Hawaiian women made up 21% of the territory's teachers, 15% of the trained nurses, 17% of the clerical workers, and 35% of the telephone operators. In agriculture, Native Hawaiian women comprised only a small proportion, 5%, of the female employees. However, they were 27% of the women operatives in the pineapple canneries. The census also revealed a greater trend of outmarriage by Native Hawaiian women than by men. In 1910, the census takers began to count Hawaiian, Caucasian Hawaiian, and Asiatic Hawaiian as distinct categories. By 1930, there were 50,860 Native Hawaiians, of which 22,636 were pure Hawaiian, 15,632 were Caucasian Hawaiian, and 12,592 were Asiatic Hawaiian. This is the first census in which the number of part Hawaiians exceeded the number of full Hawaiians. Native Hawaiian women, who distinguished themselves as leaders during this era, actively worked for women's suffrage, and then became active in politics. Three Native Hawaiian women served in the territorial legislature: Anna Kule Furtado Kahanamoku, Rosalie Enos Lyons Kili Inouye, and Bina Kalipaina Nuper Mossman. Princess Abigail Campbell Kawananakoa was the most influential in territorial politics. In 1924, after passage of the 19th Amendment, Princess Kawananakoa was the first woman delegate from Hawaii to the Republican National Convention. She distinguished herself as a champion of justice for Native Hawaiians in her advocacy of a fair trial for the Native Hawaiian and local Japanese American men who were unfairly accused and eventually acquitted of the assault and rape of Talia Massey, the wife of a Navy lieutenant. She bitterly criticized Governor Lawrence M. Judd for commuting the sentences of Massey's mother, husband, and their accomplices for the murder of one of the accused men, Joseph Kahahawai. Statehood, years, and sovereignty. After Hawaii became a state in 1959, unprecedented development transformed the landscape of island shorelines, polluted fishing grounds, drained underground water tables, and displaced Native Hawaiian fishing and farming communities. In the 1970s, a Native Hawaiian political movement emerged. Louisa Rice, a Hawaiian homesteader from Ho'olehua, Molokai, who worked as a taxi driver in Honolulu, was one of the first women to lead this movement. After a woman passenger rode in her taxi, the car burned, and upon cleaning it out, Rice found a book that had been left by the passenger, which was unscathed by the fire. The book was Hawaii's Story by Hawaii's Queen, and Rice took this as a sign that she was meant to read the book and act upon its message. Rice had an aunt, Agnes Brown, on the board of her Native Alaskan Tribal Corporation, Cook Inlet Region Incorporated, or CIRI. Given the information in the Queen's book, CIRI encouraged and provided funding for Rice to pursue a congressional law to provide reparations to Native Hawaiians for the illegal role played by U.S. troops in the overthrow of the monarchy. Louisa Rice and other Native Hawaiian community leaders founded Aboriginal Lands of Hawaiian Ancestry, or Aloha, in 1972, and worked with Hawaii's congressional delegation to introduce a bill to provide reparations to the Native Hawaiian people. When the bill languished in Congress in 1975, then-president of Aloha, Charles Kaluehi Maxwell, called for the occupation of the island of Kaho'olawe, which was being used for military live-fire training and bombing, to draw attention to the plight of the Native Hawaiians. The January 1976 occupation launched the movement to stop the bombing of the island, led by the Protect Kaho'olawe Ohana. In 1978, Congress established a Native Hawaiian Study Commission. which held hearings in Hawaii. The majority of members appointed by President Ronald Reagan were conservative Republicans from outside Hawaii. And in 1983, they reported that the United States was not responsible for the overthrow of the Hawaiian monarchy. Significantly, Native Hawaiian Republicans, who were a minority of the members, filed a report that found the United States responsible for the overthrow of the Native Hawaiian monarchy in 1893. This contradiction did not get resolved until 1993, when Native Hawaiians succeeded in having the U.S. Congress and the President of the United States offer a joint apology to Native Hawaiians for the overthrow of the Kingdom of Hawaii on January 16, 1893, with the participation of agents and citizens of the U.S. and the deprivation of the rights of Native Hawaiians to self-determination. With Queen Liliuokalani as the patron of sovereignty, Hawaiian nations continue to seek full redress, including restitution of all of the territory of the Hawaiian nation, compensation for the mismanagement and destruction of national lands and resources, and, most important, the re-establishment and recognition of a government to exercise sovereignty and self-determination. Despite statehood, the consciousness of, pride in, and practice of Native Hawaiian culture and spirituality evolved into a modern renaissance. In rallying to stop U.S. Navy bombing of the island of Kaho'olawe, the traditional concept of aloha aina, that land is sacred and must be nurtured, gained prominence. Rural Native Hawaiian communities are recognized as cultural kipuka, or strongholds of Native Hawaiian cultural practices that are organized around subsistence lifeways. Pele practitioners organize the Pele Defense Fund to stop the extraction of geothermal energy out of the Kilauea volcano as a desecration of the deity's life force. In 1994, they stopped a 500-megawatt project in the Waukele Opuna. In 2018, eruptions of Kilauea in the Lower East Rift Zone shut down the 25-megawatt geothermal plant, Puna Geothermal Ventures. Traditional navigational arts and skills were revived with trans-Pacific voyages of the Polynesian Voyaging Society on the canoes Hokulea, Hawaii Loa, in Makali'i. Both women and men are trained as navigators, captains, and crew members. Halau hula, schools of traditional Hawaiian dance and chant for both women and men, and led by both women and men kumu, or teachers, increased and flourished. La'au lapa'u, traditional herbal and spiritual healing practices, were revived as valid holistic medicinal practices. Hawaiian studies from the elementary to university level became part of the regular curricula, and Hawaiian music evolved into new forms of expression and gained popularity. In this renaissance, the knowledge and experience of Native Hawaiian kupuna, or elders, was of crucial significance. Kupuna shared their knowledge of chants, hula, legends, genealogies, place names, religious rituals, subsistence fishing and planting, astronomy, navigation, and healing practices. Among these kupuna, women were prominent and included kumu hulu trained in the Pele traditions, Edith Kanaka Kaole and Auntie Iolani Luahine from the island of Hawaii. Those schooled in the traditions of powerful spiritual kahuna and kupuna from the traditionally spiritual island of Molokai, Auntie Mary Lee, Auntie Clara Ku, Auntie Lani Kapuni, and Auntie Harriet Ney, the Native Hawaiian scholar from Kau, Hawaii, who worked as a translator, ethnographer, and resource person at the Bishop Museum on Oahu, Mary Kawena Pukui, and Oahu Kumu Hula and Cultural Resource, Emma DeFries. Through these women, the images of the cosmic gods of nature, powerful spiritual healers, and great rulers, including ancestral female gods and chiefesses, were acknowledged, respected, and honored. Diaspora. Statehood also expanded the diaspora of Native Hawaiians and other Hawaii-born residents to the U.S. continent, a trend that began after World War II. In 1950, 12.7%, or 51,955, of Hawaii-born persons lived on the U.S. continent. By 1960, that number more than doubled to 115,070, or 21.5% of Hawaii-born persons. Among Native Hawaiians in the United States in 2010, 45%, or 237,107, lived on the U.S. continent, and 55%, or 289,970, lived in Hawaii. Many Hawaiian women living on the West Coast are descendants of Native Hawaiian men who migrated and settled there for the fur trade and California gold rush in the 19th century. After World War II, Native Hawaiian women migrated for economic opportunities, to attend college, as members or dependents of the military, and for better and higher-paying jobs. Hawaiian women also migrated to the U.S. continent as entertainers. For example, the Hawaiian Room in the Lexington Hotel in New York City was known as an oasis of Hawaiian culture and entertainment, with hundreds of dancers, singers, and musicians from Hawaii performing there between 1937 and 1966. As Las Vegas boomed into a gambling and entertainment mecca, Native Hawaiian women also performed there, notably Mary Kay, who initiated the all-night lounge performances. Since the 1950s, there have now been three generations of Native Hawaiians living throughout the U.S. continent. They have sustained their connection to Hawaii and an active engagement in Hawaiian cultural activities through Hawaiian civic clubs, canoe clubs, and halau hula, hula schools, as well as regular visits to the islands. There are dynamic networks of Native Hawaiian families and communities who organize huge luau events, language classes, large community gatherings, and music concerts. Hawaiian food restaurants and craft retail stores also reinforce cultural ties. Hawaiian women and men from the continent actively participate in cultural and political events in Hawaii. Halau from the U.S. continent compete in the Merry Monarch Hula Festival. Hawaiians on the U.S. continent are enrolled in the Kanaiōwalo role to establish a sovereign Native Hawaiian government and had delegates participate in the Ahakumu Kanawai in February 2016 to draft a constitution for ratification by Native Hawaiians in Hawaii and on the continent. 1978 Constitutional Convention. A Native Hawaiian woman, Adelaide Frenchie DeSoto, affectionately known as Auntie Frenchie, was an important leader of the Hawaiian Affairs Committee of the 1978 Constitutional Convention, or CONCON. Under her leadership, the committee designed singularly important amendments that define Hawaiian rights and entitlements, and laid a solid foundation for the perpetuation of Native Hawaiian culture, language, and claims for self-governance. Through Auntie Frenchie's vision and political acumen, the amendments gained the support of the majority of CONCON delegates and approval by the majority of Hawaii voters. The Constitution designates both Hawaiian and English as the official languages of the state of Hawaii, and reaffirms and protects the exercise of Native Hawaiian rights, and provides for the promotion of the study of Hawaiian culture, history, and language. It establishes the Office of Hawaiian Affairs to advocate for Native Hawaiians and to utilize public land trust revenues to support the well-being of Native Hawaiians and recognizes Native Hawaiians and the general public as the two beneficiaries of the public land trust. Conclusion. This chapter has reviewed the vital role and agency of Native Hawaiian women throughout our history to serve as a resource to draw upon for inspiration as new challenges arise. Native Hawaiian women can reach deep and reconnect with a powerful cultural heritage to contravene the social processes of colonization that undermined, demeaned, and appropriated the standing of female ancestors. In the 21st century, Native Hawaiian women led the movement for Hawaiian sovereignty and self-determination, and continue to fulfill a wide variety of meaningful roles across the broad spectrum of a multi-ethnic society in Hawaii and the U.S. continent. Native Hawaiian women of every class are empowered by a legacy of powerful, brilliant, and enduring female ancestors. As creative life forces of nature in myths, powerful high chiefesses, national leaders, family matriarchs, educators, and healers, to take on new challenges and the struggles of everyday living. The same source that reported the disparities in health and well-being cited at the beginning of this chapter also provides an Indigenous Hawaiian approach to utilize the multi-generational wisdom and experience of our ancestors in healing, birthing, and nurturing our families, communities, and nation. Reflecting upon the experience with the island Kohemalamalama Okanaloa provides a glimmer of hope. Once the most abused island of the Hawaiian archipelago, the island is not only being healed and nurtured, it is being elevated to its original status as a most sacred island and a center for training in and mastering of Native Hawaiian culture, arts, sciences, and spiritual practices. Iola Kanaloa, Iola Nawahine. Life to Kanaloa Kaho'olawe. Life to Native Hawaiian women. 2. Global Roots and Gendered Routes. Early Asian American Women's History. Erica Lee. When my great-grandfather and great-grandmother sailed for the United States in 1919, they left my grandmother, Moisao Bick, behind in China and took her male cousin instead. Perhaps my great-grandfather believed that boys were more likely to find steady work and contribute to the family economy. It might have been safer for my grandmother, a girl, to remain in China, whereas a boy might more easily navigate the nation's anti-Chinese environment at the time. Or maybe there was no other way for my grandmother's cousin to immigrate under the Chinese exclusion laws. Passed in 1882, the Chinese Exclusion Act barred Chinese laborers from America, while allowing only select groups of Chinese to gain entry. In place until 1943, the exclusion laws separated many families and set in motion decades of immigration based on false papers and fraudulent identities. Families often bent the rules. My great-grandfather, for example, listed his nephew as his son on his immigration application, and they were admitted as merchant and son into the United States. They became part of the larger story of global migration that has shaped our modern world. But women like my grandmother did not have the same access to migration. Her father had given away her immigration slot. She would never see her mother again, and she would not come to the United States herself until 1933, when she married my grandfather, a merchant and restaurant owner in New York City. She was not alone in enduring family separation and limited immigration opportunities. Nearly all Asian immigrant women faced similar obstacles as they left their homes and crossed the ocean to America. Their stories show the importance of women and the significance of gender in shaping the causes and consequences of migration to the United States. This chapter highlights early Asian American women's history before World War II as a story of global roots and gendered routes shaped by colonialism, race, and gender inequality. Asian women in the United States are part of a longer global history of Asian migration to the Americas that followed the ebbs and flows of empires dating back to the 16th century. Imperialism in Asia caused massive civil and political unrest, economic inequality, and disruption that spurred people to leave their homes. It also established the ways and means to initiate and sustain global mass migration. The Spanish Empire, with colonies in the Philippines and New Spain, present-day Mexico, Puerto Rico, Cuba, Florida, and parts of the United States and Central America, first connected Asia and the Americas through colonization and trade, and sent the first Asians to the Americas. The rise of the British Empire in South Asia and China caused massive economic dislocation, established regular trans-Pacific trade, and inaugurated the business and profitability of mass migration. Japanese colonialism in Korea turned Koreans into refugees, while Japan's imperial ambitions displaced many Japanese farmers and laborers who sought their futures abroad. And, as the United States became a world power and expanded its reach into Asia, Asians started coming to America as part of these imperial crossings. This chapter is also a story of gendered roots, That is, the ways in which gender shaped migration, determining who could come, how, and under which conditions. Up through the mid-20th century, the numbers of Asian immigrant women were small compared to those of their male counterparts, because of their uneven and unequal access to migration. Patriarchy and gender inequality in both Asia and the United States discouraged women from migrating. Moreover, U.S. immigration policies favored male migrants. This would not change until after World War II, and especially after 1965, when the numbers of Asian immigrant women became more equal, and sometimes surpassed those of men. Because most studies either focus on the more numerous men who came in the pre-World War II era, or on the feminization of contemporary migration, in which women are the majority of U.S. immigrants, this early history is significant and fills an important historiographical gap. The global roots and gendered routes of Asian women and girls reveal much about how colonialism and gender shaped early migration and migrant lives in the Americas. It also demonstrates how gender inequality interacted with racism to impact both foreign and U.S.-born Asian Americans. Asian women's voices and experiences are thus important in understanding this history of Asian immigration and the formation of communities in the global Asian diaspora. Some women suffered terribly. However, Asian immigrant women, a diverse group with varied economic and ethnic backgrounds, negotiated their way into the nation, where they helped shape early Asian America and made it possible for later generations of Asian immigrant women to follow in their footsteps. First journeys. From 1565 to 1815, up to 100,000 Asians from China, Japan, the Philippines, and South and Southeast Asia were taken to the Americas as Europe's age of exploration and colonization increasingly linked Asia to the New World. They came as sailors, servants, and slaves on Spanish trading vessels that brought porcelain, spices, furniture, and silk from Asia, and returned with silver pesos from Mexico and Peru. This first wave of Asian migrants became an important part of the Americas. The locals collectively called them Los Chinos. Asian women came as either servants or slaves. Women from India, Malacca, and Maluku were known to be excellent seamstresses, cooks, and preparers of conserves, and are neat and clean in service, according to one observer. Others were captured for sale as concubines or sex slaves, and faced particularly harrowing ordeals. Spanish officials and nobles often brought Filipino women on board the ships as concubines and then abandoned them upon reaching Acapulco. Perhaps the most well-known Chino in New Spain was Mira Catarina de San Juan. Mira was only 12 years old when she was abducted by Portuguese slave traders in southwestern India, sold in Manila to a Spanish captain, Miguel de Sosa, and taken to Puebla, Mexico in 1610 as a slave. Captain de Sosa married her to another Asian slave, but Mira refused to be a wife. Instead, she dedicated her life to Christ and became a healer and a Catholic visionary who worked among the poor and sick. Mira was so revered that the Jesuit order nominated her for sainthood. She became a local heroine and the inspiration for La China Poblana, the Chinese Asian girl from Puebla town, an iconic symbol of Mexican womanhood, representing the beauty and strength of local culture and people over imported European tastes and colonialism. A statue of Mira still stands in the main plaza in Puebla. Coolie women in the West Indies. Between 1838 and 1918, more than 419,000 South Asians went to British West Indian plantations in British Guiana, Trinidad, and Jamaica as coolies or indentured laborers, replacing or working alongside African slaves in these and other British plantations throughout the empire. Another 250,000 Chinese were similarly brought to Cuba and Peru. They were mostly men. But, In the West Indies, women soon played an important role in the indenture system. Planters sought to bind the overwhelmingly male labor force to the plantations by recruiting women to encourage permanent settlement. Sujaria Bahadur was one coolie woman who sailed from Calcutta in 1903 and landed 3 months later in British Guiana. She joined a growing number of widows, runaways, and outcasts who endured lives of hard labor and sometimes sexual exploitation. Over the decades, both male and female indentured laborers from South Asia became central to sugar production in the West Indies. By 1891, they made up over 80% of the workforce on British Guianan sugar plantations. The work was divided according to sex, age, ability, and experience. Gangs of men took on the hardest physical work of forking and cutting sugarcane, sometimes working alongside freed blacks who performed the heaviest manual labor. Women weeded, and young boys tended livestock. In the fields, women often worked as many hours as the men, even in the advanced stages of pregnancy. Yet, they earned less than men and were prohibited from working in higher paying and higher status positions on the plantations. Women also cooked, cleaned, and cared for their children in their homes. Their double duty often meant waking before dawn and toiling until the late hours of night. They were also vulnerable to sexual exploitation. According to a government commission, overseers commonly kept Hindu and Muslim females as paramours or concubines. On another plantation, women were regularly brought in by the South Asian overseer to serve as prostitutes for the male workers. Condemning these and other abuses, the Indian government suspended emigration in 1917 and abolished the indenture system in 1920. Chinese women in America. U.S. imperialism helped to initiate emigration from China. Afong Moy, the first recorded Chinese woman in the United States, was brought into New York Harbor in 1834 as one of the treasures aboard the Washington, a vessel owned by two U.S.-China traders. The 19-year-old was exhibited twice a day in an elaborate national costume within an ornately decorated set of exotic screens, furniture, lamps, and fans from Asia. Moy was instructed to walk around to display her bound feet and answer questions from viewers through an interpreter. The cost for viewing her was 50 cents. One newspaper account did report that after Moy was approached to fulfill a specific request for the general public to see her unbound feet, she demanded that the admission price double to $1 for this invasion of her person and privacy. This response on her part suggests that Moy was not without some agency. Still, Afong Moy not only represents the ways in which white Americans profited from Asian bodies, she also reveals how U.S.-China relations were rooted in imperial, racial, and gender inequalities. The Afong Moy exhibit sent a clear message. China and the Chinese were exotic, different, and inferior. China and Chinese women were commodities for the West to acquire. By the 1850s, the California Gold Rush had propelled tens of thousands of Chinese to America. Domestic crises and foreign intervention in China sustained and expanded their emigration over several decades. Once the conditions and the means for migration were established, Chinese, the majority of whom were men, left their homeland in droves. The traditional Chinese patriarchal system discouraged and even forbade decent women from traveling overseas. Chinese folk sayings instructed that a woman's duty is to care for the household, and she should have no desire to go abroad. Women married to male migrants were expected to remain in China, take care of their husbands' parents, and perform the filial duties of their absent husbands. Some women were also valued agricultural workers at home. Others, especially those of the merchant class, did not want to leave their comfortable lives. Harsh living conditions, high levels of anti-Chinese violence, expensive trans-Pacific transportation, and the lack of jobs for women were additional factors that discouraged Chinese women from immigrating. U.S. immigration laws also presented formidable barriers to female Chinese immigration. The 1875 Page Act barred Asian women suspected of prostitution, as well as Asian males transported to the country as contract laborers. Under the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, only merchants, students, teachers, diplomats, and travelers, professions held almost exclusively by men in 19th century China, were exempted from exclusion. Most women were simply not eligible to enter independently. Court cases initiated by Chinese in the United States eventually allowed for wives and children of Chinese merchants and U.S. citizens of Chinese descent to come. But Chinese women could not initiate immigration on their own. Because their admission was based on their relationship to a male relative, they were forced to rely on their husbands or fathers to sponsor them. Moreover, their own right to enter and remain in the country was based on their sponsor's legal immigration status as well. As a result, women accounted for only 0.3% of all Chinese admitted in 1880 and 0.7% in 1900. The small numbers of women brought to the United States by the end of the 19th century included prostitutes who had been kidnapped, lured, or purchased and imported as indentured or enslaved laborers. Some became concubines or mistresses to wealthy Chinese men. But most were sold to parlor houses in Chinatown that catered to well-to-do Chinese and white men. Those who ended up in alley cribs, small, sparsely furnished shacks, were forced to entice customers until they were sold again or died from venereal disease. While many Chinese prostitutes were virtual slaves, a few found new lives. Polly Bemis, La Luna Thoi, had been sold into prostitution as a young girl in China and brought to San Francisco and then to Idaho. Through perseverance and luck, she eventually gained her freedom, married, and owned and operated a boarding house and ranch. She became respected as a businesswoman and community member. Her house is now a museum on the National Register of Historic Places. As Chinese men decided to stay in the United States, an increasing number of women came as their wives or daughters. Many viewed both marriage and immigration in terms of economic opportunities and choice. Others did not. Bandits in China had robbed La Shilo's parents of their possessions and destroyed their farmland. "We had no food to go with rice, not even soy sauce or black bean paste," she recalled. Some neighboring families begged for food or even sold their daughters. "That was when my parents decided to marry me off to a Gamsanhak, Gold Mountain Man, from the next village," Law explained. "They thought I would have a better future in Gold Mountain." When she left for the United States in 1922, La Shilo was 18. By 1910, women were 9.7% of all new Chinese immigrants, increasing to 20% in 1920 and 30% by 1930. Most Chinese immigrant women worked alongside their husbands in family restaurants, shops, and laundries. Some worked for wages in factories, canneries, and other businesses. By World War I, Chinese women dominated the garment industry in San Francisco. Some immigrant families took in boarders to add to their income, and it was the wife's job to prepare food and clean for the additional household members. Juggling their dual responsibilities as homemakers and wage earners, Chinese women were indispensable partners in their family's struggles for economic survival in the United States. By the late 19th and early 20th centuries, Chinese American women were seeking out education, working outside the home, and participating in community activities. Some, like Mary Tape, took an active role in the nationalist movement in China and in the struggle for equality in the United States. In 1884, Mary and Joseph Tape went to enroll their daughter Mamie in San Francisco's Spring Valley School. School officials and the San Francisco School Board refused their application in an attempt to establish racial segregation in the public schools. The family launched a legal fight for equal access to education. They sued the San Francisco Board of Education and argued that as a native-born U.S. citizen, Mamie was entitled to the free education that was every American's birthright. San Francisco Superior Court Judge James McGuire agreed. The San Francisco School Board responded by establishing a separate Chinese primary school in the Chinatown district. Although it was not the outcome that the tapes wanted, Mamie and her younger brother Frank were the first two students to show up for class when the school opened in 1885. The tapes' legal challenge had affirmed that Chinese children in the United States had the right to a public education, albeit one that was still separate from whites. Japanese women in America. The first organized group of Japanese immigrants, including six women, arrived in Hawaii in 1868 to work on the sugar plantations. Between 1885 and 1924, 200,000 Japanese went to Hawaii, and 180,000 more went to the U.S. continent. Some women came as students, but most of the early immigrants were men from farming families who struggled to make ends meet. As the Japanese government imposed high taxes to fund its modernization, industrialization, and imperial ambitions, emigration netsu, or fever to go to America, continued to spur young men abroad. Male laborers under contract in Hawaii could come as family units or send for wives as soon as could be arranged. In addition, after the United States annexed Hawaii in 1898, the Gentlemen's Agreement, 1907 to 1908, which barred Japanese laborers, still allowed Japanese and Korean wives, children, and parents to join men in Hawaii and on the U.S. continent. Unmarried men often had their families arrange marriages for them by proxy, through an exchange of information and photographs. From 1908 to 1920, 20,000 Japanese women arrived until the 1921 Ladies' Agreement ended the practice of these proxy marriages. However, men could return to Japan to marry and bring back their wives until the passage of the 1924 Immigration Act ended all Japanese immigration. Consequently, the Japanese-American sex ratio was the most balanced among all Asian immigrant communities, and contributed to an increase in the birth of large numbers of U.S.-born citizen Japanese-American children. When their ships arrived in San Francisco or Honolulu, many picture brides faced rude awakenings. Sometimes the photographs of the handsome, young, and well-dressed men sent to Japan were years old and did not represent the aged, wrinkled, and pockmarked farmers who appeared before them. Women's dashed expectations and harsh lives in America often led to lifelong disappointments and difficult, if not failed, marriages. A few disillusioned brides asked to return to Japan on the next ship. Others left their husbands, and notices of these desertions often appeared in the Japanese language press. Still, many Japanese women overcame their disappointment and stayed. Some were eager to embark on an adventure abroad. Others reluctantly followed their parents' wishes. Marrying a Japanese man on the U.S. continent or Hawaii was considered a good marriage, and daughters were expected to send money home to help support the family. This appealed to Kame Iwatani, who had heard that in Hawaii you can earn money. Like their Chinese counterparts, Japanese immigrant women assumed crucial roles to support their family and their communities. In Hawaii, women worked in sugarcane fields, pineapple canneries, and laundries, served as midwives, barbers, tailors, seamstresses, and domestic workers, and ran businesses, boarding houses, and hotels. They supplemented family wages by washing, cooking, and sewing for male plantation laborers. They also played an important role in the labor movement through their participation in the plantation workers' strikes of 1909 and 1920. The women on the U.S. continent worked on farms, ran small businesses with their families, operated boarding houses, and performed domestic work. They developed important community organizations, raised their U.S. citizen, Nisei, or second-generation children, and helped build the foundations of early Japanese America. Korean women in America. Korean immigrant women's journeys overseas were also shaped by imperialism, but it was the Japanese who controlled their homeland. As part of its expansion in East Asia, Japan declared Korea a protectorate in 1905 and formally annexed it in 1910. Harsh colonial policies designed to control the Korean population followed. The Korean army was disbanded. Korean teachers were replaced with Japanese ones. Korean language was no longer taught in schools, newspapers were closed down, and the Japanese controlled Buddhist temples and Christian churches. Koreans lived in daily fear of the Japanese secret police and deeply resented being colonized. Many sought refuge abroad and freedom from persecution. About 7,400 Koreans left for Hawaii between 1902 and 1905 before Japanese rule. Another 600 political refugees and about 1,060 picture brides came to America from 1905 to 1924, before the Immigration Act of 1924 ended Asian immigration. Like other Asian immigrants, Koreans were predominantly young and male. Only 10% were women. The imbalanced sex ratio gradually grew more even with the arrival of picture brides. In 1920, 75% of the Korean population on the U.S. continent was male. In 1930, it was 66%. Like Japanese women, Korean picture brides were at the mercy of matchmakers and suitors who exaggerated the truth, including the ages and economic status of the men seeking to marry them. Thus, many of them were unprepared for their harsh new lives, barely scraping by as plantation laborers or migratory farm workers. Their husbands expected and needed their wives to work for wages as well as maintain the house and raise children. Because their husbands were often much older than them, some women needed to work even harder to support their families when their husbands became too old and too infirm to continue working. Worse yet, they could become widows at a very young age. One woman was in Hawaii for only 7 years when her husband passed away. Still, she persisted. "It was very sad and depressing, but I could not spare the time and energy for crying," she explained. "I had all my 5 young children and myself to support. I worked without rest, straight through the week." With grit and perseverance, Korean immigrant women survived and played central roles supporting and leading Korean nationalist efforts that would one day lead to Korea's independence. They knew from firsthand experience the terror of Japanese colonial rule, sometimes even more than their husbands who had left Korea before the Japanese annexation. They infused their family lives with Korean language and culture, while also helping to form Korean-American ethnic identities. They spearheaded important nationalist activities through Korean churches and other groups. And they also organized their own separate women's organizations to support Korean independence by raising funds and spreading the nationalist message. South Asian women in America. Early South Asian immigrants to the United States were a diverse group of Sikhs, Muslims, and Hindus. The majority came from the Punjab region of modern-day India and Pakistan, an area that was most affected by British rule beginning in the 19th century. Farming losses combined with high British taxes led many families into poverty and indebtedness. The Punjab also suffered heavily from a population explosion, famines, and severe epidemics. By the early 20th century, the stage was set for unprecedented South Asian migration abroad. A diverse group of male students and laborers sought to escape their economically depressed homeland. Many would become involved in the Ghadar Indian nationalist movement abroad to seek freedom for themselves and for the cause of an independent India. Most migrants were young single men. A few women and children came, but they were rare. Those who did were often from the landed, educated, and professional classes. Kala and Vaishno Das Bagai and their 3 sons were among the few who arrived in the United States as a family. For them, emigration was a political act. The couple sought the end of British rule in India and wanted to raise their children in America. But the sight of a South Asian woman was such a rare occurrence that Kala's arrival in 1915 with her family was covered by the San Francisco Call Post. The Bagais bought a home, ran an import business and general store, and became involved in the San Francisco-based Ghadar Party. But life in America was difficult. Kala struggled with everyday tasks of learning English, shopping, and caring for her three young boys. The family also faced overt discrimination from their neighbors after they bought a home in Berkeley, California. Their unequal status had a great impact on their lives. Although Vaishno had become a naturalized citizen in 1921, the U.S. Supreme Court's ruling in the 1923 Bhagat Singh Thin case ordered the denaturalization of all South Asian immigrants on the grounds that they were not white. Feeling trapped and betrayed, Vaishno committed suicide by gas poisoning in 1928. After his death, Kala struggled. But she focused on raising her children and getting them off to college. She eventually remarried. In 1946, the Loose Seller Act allowed South Asians to naturalize, and Kala and her sons finally became U.S. citizens. Filipinas in America. U.S. colonization of the Philippines in 1898 set in motion the second wave of Filipino migration to the Americas, following the thousands who came during the Manila Galleon era. U.S. rule transformed the Philippine economy to benefit American investors, but not Filipinos. American companies bought farmland for export crops. By the 20th century, the Philippines was exporting so many agricultural products and natural resources that it could no longer feed itself. Dislocation and inequalities followed as small family farms became divided into unsustainable plots by the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Tenancy, landlessness, poverty, and emigration followed. The proliferation of American culture also spurred migration. With missionaries, teachers, doctors, and other Americans active throughout the Philippines as part of U.S. imperial efforts to uplift the country, Filipinos were schooled from a young age to admire the United States and to think of themselves as American. With its commitment to freedom and democracy, America was believed to be a land of paradise. American laws facilitated Filipino migration as part of its colonial agenda. The first group of second-wave Filipino men and women came at the invitation of the U.S. government. Under the Pensionado Act of 1903, a few thousand elite Filipino students, known as pensionados, were recruited to attend American universities, act as goodwill ambassadors, and lend support to U.S. efforts in the Philippines. After returning to the Philippines, these elites drew upon their American experiences to become successful and powerful pro-U.S. leaders of the Philippines. The vast majority of the pensionados were men. Of the more than 200 students in the first year, only 8 were women. But one of them, Honoria Acosta Sison, became the Philippines' first female physician. By the early 20th century, Hawaiian plantation labor recruiters had identified the Philippines as the next source of labor from Asia, and 150,000 Filipinos migrated across the Pacific. Here, too, men predominated. In 1930, there were only 2,500 Filipino women out of 42,500 Filipinos in California. The first few women who did migrate to America came as students, accompanied their husbands, or were sent to join family already there. The small numbers of Filipino women were revered because they were so rare. Camila Labor Carido, who came to Stockton, California in 1929 to join her father, soon found that she and the other women were like diamonds to the Filipinos. They played important roles, building families, contributing to family economies, and keeping bonds of extended family strong. Through women's organizations, Filipinas took leadership positions and helped organize events that built community ties and promoted Filipino culture, such as beauty queen contests, cultural performances, sports tournaments, and church functions. Gendered routes through Angel Island and U.S. immigration laws and practices. The Angel Island Immigration Station in San Francisco was one of the main sites where both the global routes and gendered routes of Asian female migration intersected. From 1910 to 1940, Angel Island served as the processing and detention center for 500,000 immigrants, including 20,000 Chinese women, 25,000 Japanese women, 200 Korean women, 100 South Asian women, and 200 Filipinas. Gender, as well as national origin, race, and class, shaped immigration policies and Asian immigrant women's experiences at the immigration station. Policies like the Chinese exclusion laws and the 1900s.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.